harp, and also its coat. Now the coat was without seam and woven from top throughout. Then said, therefore among themselves, let us not rend it, but cast lots for it. Whose shall it be? That the scripture might be fulfilled, they parted my raiment among them, and my vesture did they cast lots. These things, therefore, the soldiers. Very quickly, I look and I see soldiers who are, in essence, playing games at the foot of the cross. At the foot of the cross is no place to play games, but it's a place to lift our eyes to the Son of God, who was crucified. Mother stood by the cross of Jesus, his mother, and his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Caiaphas and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother and the disciples standing by, whom he loved, he said unto his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciples, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, that disciple took her unto his own home. See, part of the struggle is, you know, Jesus' siblings, Brother David, grew up with him, and they didn't really recognize and sometimes believe. And so now the responsibility, Jesus says, "You know who I am." To his mother. He says to John, "Take care of my mother." There would come time where things would change. And this disciple, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that scripture might be fulfilled, said, "I thirst." And there was set a vessel full of vinegar, and they filled a sponge with vinegar and put hyssop and put it to his mouth. When Jesus therefore had received the vinegar, he said, "It is finished." The greatest words that you and I can ever hear from Scripture is the knowledge that Jesus said, "Redemption. It is finished." Wouldn't you like to hear those words as he's, "It is finished"? But spiritually we have heard that when we accept the atoning work of Jesus Christ. And he bowed his head and he gave up the ghost. He died from his wounds. He freely gave up his life. The Jews, therefore, because it was the preparation, the body should not remain upon the cross on the Sabbath day, for the Sabbath day was at high day, besought Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. Then came the soldiers and broke the legs of the first and the other which was crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus, they saw that he was dead already. They broke knowledge. Why? For fulfillment of Scripture. But one of the soldiers with a spear pierced his side, and forthwith came there out blood and water. And he that saw it bare record, and his record is true, and he knows what he says is true, that you might believe. These things were done, that scripture should be fulfilled. A bone of him shall not be broken. And again, another scripture said, they shall look on him whom they pierced. I'm going to give you an opportunity here in just a few moments. God keeps every word. Jesus fulfilled every prophecy. He is the Son of God. Tonight, as we continue to go throughout this week, I know it gets busy with life. There's jobs, there's responsibilities. But can I ask us to try to take some time to be intentional, to think of the price that was paid for us? Take time to think of that place called Golgotha, where God's own Son gave His life for us. Brother Dustin, it wasn't a Roman soldier. Brother Craig, it wasn't the wicked Sanhedrin. It wasn't anyone else but God's own choice and design that allowed Jesus to die on Calvary for the redemption of sinners, which is you and I. I just want to stop here tonight. How about you? Something that speaks to you from the history, this story of the betrayal, the crucifixion, and even the resurrection. Brother David. A
couple quick things. One, you had mentioned about this trial was at 6 o'clock in the morning. That was in violation of Roman law.
Yes.
Their trials in court was to be open air and in public, so it could withstand public scrutiny. Even though there was a crowd crying for his crucifixion, had this been in public, there would have been many that would have rose up. But they did this at night. It was a political move. Politics is very ugly. But not only did Jesus suffer physically, and he suffered unbelievable physical trauma, there was also great emotional and spiritual distresses also. He started preparing his disciples weeks, if not months ahead of time, that he was going to suffer at the hands of the chief priests and sinners. But as they got closer to this week, that vision of that and understanding of that was growing. And we see Christ in his humanity. I believe that it started at dinner that night before when he said that one amongst you is going to betray me. And he knew what, finally he says to Judas, whatever you're going to do, do it quickly. And then in the garden, Luke records this, that he began to pray even more earnestly, having been in great agony, and he sweat. His sweat was, as it were, great drops of blood. He was under tremendous pressure at this point. David, I believe it was a cave-in, I think the name is Adullam. When David had the chance to kill Saul, we read where David said, and his men were after him, and he said, I am amongst lions. I am amongst those whose teeth are set on edge. And it's a picture of the emotional suffering of Christ. David also, one of the Psalms, talks about that I am surrounded by the bulls of Bashan. And that is a picture of Christ being there. They're coming in on him. And there was great stresses. And then also bearing the sins of the world. He began to bear the sins of the world in the garden. And that's a very heavy emotional toll. So we see Christ in his humanity. We like to think, I just told someone I heard earlier this week, I was talking with them, I hope they helped me with something. And I mentioned about Jesus, and they said, well, he was the Almighty. But he was also man of very man. God of very God, man of very man. So throughout this passion, we see his great humanity. And we see him, there was this great inner turmoil and stress of bearing the pressures of the sins of the world. And then Dr. Mark DeHaan, I don't forget the name of that ministry, his son took over for him then after he died. The first Dr. DeHaan, the father, was a medical doctor. And if you ever get a chance to look it up on the internet or find it in a bookstore, the book that he wrote about the sufferings of Jesus is unbelievable. There was not a moment of relief let on the cross. And he explains what physiologically happened. If he took pressure off the back of his neck and his spine, and he let himself weigh down, that the pain would shoot so much up his back, and that at times the cross was not only bloody and torturous, but it was noisy, the convulsions, the shaking. And we do see at that moment the great sacrifice of Christ for our sins. In the Old Testament, when you come into the tabernacle, and you see the priest at the big brazen altar, and also the where they did the washing and things. Those priests were covered many times all over in blood because of the sacrifices. And that's a type of the suffering of Jesus Christ. And I think of Isaiah tonight where he says that his visage was marred above that of any man. They beat him to a pulp. They pulled out his beard. And then what you just said, what great words of victory when he said, it is finished. We've been atoned for. And I think about this week, I love Holy Week. Because Pentecostals don't like to refer to it as Holy Week. I guess the Methodist in me from a kid still comes out. I love this week of reflection and thinking back. But in thinking about all his physical sufferings, think about the emotion and spiritual struggle that he went through. And even so, it says in Luke that the angels came and ministered to him. And when you read in Hebrews, Sunday I read the verse from Hebrews, that he, by the eternal Spirit of God, offered himself up. How in the world could Jesus have gone through that? The Holy Spirit, the eternal Spirit of God in him. And the culmination of all that will be one day when we walk into the pearly gates and we have no right to hear this. We don't deserve to hear it, but because of his blood, we will hear, well, done no good and faithful service.
Praise God.
And come down into the joy.
Praise God. Praise God.
I like Easter more than I do Christmas.
I'm glad it's not clouded with all the festivities. I mean, really, it's, and I'm like you, Brother David, I'm all right with looking at a Holy Week, what's happening, what's transpiring. When we use the word meditate, we're not talking about meditation of like Buddhist meditation. We're talking about meditating on the Word of God. That's what David talked about, meditation. That's beautiful. Very good. Thank you. Thank you. I've never read that book, but I've heard of that. That's been around a long time.
As if many things in Bible school, I read enough to get through to pass the test.
Sure.
But I've read an awful lot about it, though, too. And I think I had the book at one time, but I lost so many of my books in a flood in the basement here a couple of years ago. But I'm sure you can Google that and see the things that he suffered. Yeah. And he goes into the entire nervous system and things. And the horrible death.
I think, as I said before, it can become kind of ordinary back to us, but we sometimes lose how powerful it was. Someone else, something like Splintering.
This may have been very, very deep, but I came up with wonder when John was penning, was writing, you know, these accounts now, that due to his close relationship with the Lord, that I wonder, he just paused, even though it was written years and years after the crucifixion, that it was still, it had to be so tenderly fresh yet with John, even after all these years, you know. And I can just picture him, you know, writing this down and then pausing with tears streaming down his face, you know, and dripping down onto the parchment or whatever, you know, and just reflecting back on that, you know, and just pausing, maybe getting up and walking around a little bit, you know, just to collect the salts and things, you know. And it had to be a very, very tender moment as he was writing this down.
That's good. No, that is deep. Because we can reflect on our life. We're at the age where we can look back, and there are some moments that we can relive very vividly. Yeah, so that's good. And he is looking back. And he's probably sharing things that the other gospel writers didn't share, because now I see, but these are the details the Holy Ghost is putting in my heart to share. That I think is necessary.
It's nothing big, but every year I still can't get past the fact that God Almighty, from the very beginning, we know that God would send his son. see that all the way back in Genesis. But God, in his infinite knowledge of any time in history, he could send them. I mean, any time. I mean, I think about my own life. I mean, even going through Bible college, I talked around and I got the easiest professors that I knew I could get that I get an easy A, so I could put my GPA up. I took the easy way. You know, I did the work. I made the things. But I was work smarter, not harder. But yet, God, in all his knowledge, looked down their history and chose the most painful and horrific method. I mean, he could have been killed in any fashion he wanted to. I mean, we see it laid out in the tabernacle. But if he really wanted to, God could have killed his son in the easiest way possible. He could have sent him down on, 21st century in New York City and had him run down or something. You know, he could have died in any way for the sins of man. But he chose the most horrific time. He didn't choose the easiest time in history when there was indoor plumbing or heating and, you know, cuddle up somewhere, warm insulation. He chose 1st century Jerusalem, Bethlehem, to be born. And when you look at the time, he could have picked any time in history. But he chose to die by way of the cross. And not one of the easiest times in his life either. And that just still baffles me. That, I mean, we get our word for something that's painful and something beyond comprehension when it comes to pain. Excruciating pain. That word excruciating comes out of the cross, out of crucifixion. And God, in his infinite knowledge, still chose, if you want to say killed or laid up for the sins of man, sacrificed for the sins of mankind, in the most horrific way possible. And he went above and beyond because he wasn't just crucified, but he was scourged. He was beaten to a pulp. He was, for his stripes, we were healed. He was crowned with thorns. He went the most horrific way possible. And he could have chosen any way at any time, but he chose then and there and that day.
I have to agree with you. I'm amazed by that most often, too. Because he left the glories of heaven. Anytime you come to earth, it's going to be terrible. Verses 7, you know what I mean? But, yeah, to choose, but he didn't look at what was best for him. He looked at what was best for us.
Well, I don't know if I would do that for myself. I really don't. Knowing what's on, I don't know if I would do it for myself. I really don't. And I probably wouldn't.
Aren't you just glad he's God? I'm glad he's God. I agree with you. Yeah, I agree. Give me air conditions, give me automobiles, give me a nice home, you know what I mean? But now I wouldn't worry about that. I'd worry about the condition.
And building on what Justin said, Eric said, the effect that it had on the disciples, as you read through the book of Acts, these guys were preachers of the cross and of the resurrection. And when we become preachers of the cross and the resurrection, we will see the works of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We see the miraculous. Beware of those who preach a gospel that is void of the cross.
That's right.
Because it was in the cross, he spoiled principalities and powers. So there's a lot of preaching today that's it. You have to be very careful. It's very subtle. But if you listen to it close enough, it's really nothing more than self-help stuff. And there was one famous preacher, I remember about 15 years ago, one of the hoodies, I'll tell you in the foyer. But he made the comment that he did not like a bloody gospel because it was too gruesome. He refused to preach the bloody gospel. And at the time, he pastored one of the largest churches in the United States with one of the largest worldwide ministries. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel. And Paul said to the Corinthians, when I was among you, I knew nothing other than Jesus Christ and him crucified.
Without the cross, there's no salvation. Without the blood, there's no salvation. And let me tell you, the church has swiftly moved to that. It will build in great numbers when you know the virtue of Jesus Christ on the cross. When you use a philosophy,
how to feel happy. How to get as much from God as you possibly can. There's truth, there's some truth there. You know, God does give us, and he does bless us. But there's two sides to every truth. There's two sides to the coin. And the other side of the coin is not what we can get from God, but what can we give to God?
It should always be what we can give to God, because we will become recipients when we give to God. I can talk forever about what you just said. The dots back on my just being saved does not mean we're always going to be happy.
Life happens.
But in the middle of it all, we have joy that's deeper than the sorrow that we're experiencing.
But people bow at the altar of happiness today, Pastor, and it's quite disturbing. We're married 35 years. I think that's how long we've been married now. 34 years, going on 35. Have we always been happy? No. But get over it. You know, it's not about me being happy. It's about my responsibility to the woman that I promised that I would have a responsibility to, and to the children. Did I always want to come home from work over the years when I was raising the kids? No. I want to. Because I knew I had to face not problems with them, but just life. But you know what? You come home because you can't turn your back on that. But I look at some of the stuff that I'm seeing on social media, and I listen to little snippets of some preaching from here and there, and maybe I'm wrong, but I see an awful lot of self-help junk out there. Preach the word. But at ordination service, they said to us, preach the word. Be instant in season and out of season. They didn't say, preach to make them happy, preach to help them to have a better life. He's the giver of life. And for some reason, I don't know, that's my pet peeve the last week or two. We talked about that last weekend a little bit. But we need to be careful. We need to be preachers and teachers of the cross and of the resurrection and of the Holy Ghost. Paul said, when I came unto you, my words were not with enticing words of men's wisdom, but in power and in demonstration of the Holy Ghost.
Amen. Amen. That's what real happiness is. Presence.
I love these people. I'm sorry to say this. I love these people who have six steps to victory. I do one step to victory. I fall on my face before God.
Amen.
Now, I bet the last 10 years of my life I don't fall on my face. It's physically impossible. It takes several strong men to pick me up again. But the condition of heart is I fall on my face before God. I'm just not smart enough for that other stuff.
Well, when it's not lying before God, that's what we all have to ask ourselves. Let's stand tonight.
You know, where you the gospel the way Paul said. Because Paul said, if anything, he said, any other doctrine than this, then it be a curse. And there's so many out there that are not preaching the full gospel according to the word of God. And you guys killed my Lord. Because how would you feel if you turn what is right and your old family comes against you, just like the Jews coming, the own people turn you against Jesus? How do you feel about it? And the priest, when he came out of the tomb, and them soldiers went and told the priest, they knew that he was risen, but they said, so they the money said, go and say that his disciples came. So they knew he was risen. But they denied it.
That's good word.
So you deny now Jesus himself out.
I still believe he felt love and compassion to them.
Yeah.
He had to grieve now.
just like he loves us too then. No matter what we do, he smiles down on us and says, I forgive.
Love will always tell the truth, won't it?
Yes, you will.
And the truth sometimes hurts. The truth sometimes hurts. Stay with me tonight. One thing that I used to hear growing up, you know, my pastor wasn't like some one beat you up with a baseball bat. It was just phenomenal. But he'd say, I don't want to step on your toes, but I might step on your toes. The truth sometimes will step on our toes. But that's okay.
And my favorite say, if I step on your toes, don't be afraid to stay out.
There you go. Amen, Brother Eli, close us in prayer.
Oh, Lord, we thank you, Lord, for this service tonight, Lord. For the teaching, Lord, that we have learned so much from it, Lord. And thank you, Lord, for giving your life for us, Lord. And we can be free from sin, Lord. Thank you, Jesus, for yourself. Down on that cross of Calvary. And the pain and the suffering that you did for us. We just want to thank you, Lord. So we love you so much. Oh, Lord. God bless you, Lord. It's to have a close and close walk with you as we have never had before, Lord. Help us, Lord, to see what thou art to be, Lord. Only through you, Lord, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Appreciate you being here. God bless you.